Welcome to Burn Books. There's a bathroom here, two exits. And so tonight we have Scott Crow. We're very happy to come. He's come, well, we drove last night from New York City, and I got to know Scott, and I'm very excited to hear him speak. He's a longtime activist, and I'm sure we'll get a lot out of that. So also there's this thing going on, which I think probably a lot of people know about, but Leslie and Teresa and fam and Eliza are here up on this in this U.S. out of my living room. The FBI have been harassing. It's been going on, ongoing thing with Leslie for, I don't know, decade or more. Yeah. And so there's been like four or five different instances where we've like, you know, like they say they're like, the FBI are like cockroaches, and you see one, there's a lot more going on. But anyway, so we were lucky to find a couple little mouse turds around. And it's turned out that, you know, they are, either whether it's harassment or whether it's they're actually trying to build a case, either way, it's absolutely, you know, against all our rights. It's not acceptable. We know who the real criminals are and who are trying to eco-terrorists and all these type of things. So. This Wednesday, from 6 to 8, at the First Amendment Club, which is at 93 Bridgman Street of Buffalo, across the street from Wegmans. That's where Amherst is where Bridgman Street is. We really encourage everybody to come out. Michael Kuzma and Leslie will do a little talking about that. There'll be food. Morgan has been doing a lot of great support work, and we're very thankful for that. And everybody else. So if anybody, please, we're gonna pass these flyers out. And if anybody wants to pass them around, we very much encourage you to put it up on your refrigerator if you don't want to bring it somewhere else. Also, Scott has experienced a lot of this type of harassment for doing positive things in the community. And so he's actually wanting to have it be a fundraiser in support of that also. So we're gonna pass around the hat, and if people could, throw something for that, we greatly appreciate. We're doing FOIAs and stuff to find out why they're investigating Leslie, because they obviously don't want to talk about those things. So we're trying to shed the light on it. And without further ado, here's Scott.
Oh, is that me?
That's you.
Thank you so much for coming out on a rainy night. But I recognize that it rains a lot here, right? So. My name is Scott Crow. I'm from Austin, Texas. I've been living there for about 12 years, and I've been an activist and organizer for about 25 years. I'm going to tell you some stories tonight, and I want to tell you these stories not because I want you to leave here thinking that I'm a hero or that people did things that you couldn't do or wouldn't want to do, that hopefully those who are not engaged in stuff will become engaged in stuff and that you will see yourself in those stories. Because if we want social, ecological, and change in this world, economic change in this world, it's going to take all of us to do it, right? And there is no great white hope that's going to take us out of this. Nobody. And I want to tell you also that everything I talk about is coming from my experience and my analysis, but it doesn't represent everything that happens, and I recognize that. It's my experience, and I think that's really important to recognize. I'm an anarchist, but I don't represent all the strains of anarchism that are out there, or anarchy that are out there. And I think that's important to talk about. And I was going to take you on a little journey through some different sections tonight, and I hope that's okay with you, about how we're all born knowing that things are wrong, and that how we start to become educated and start to change those, and how we can develop tools along the way, and some of the pitfalls that can happen. Is that a journey that y'all can go on with me tonight?
Yeah.
Yeah. And my caveat is I'm trying out a new presentation architecture today, and it may mess up a little bit, so bear with me for a second, because you're the only second people for me to test it out on. So, some of this is going to be based on my book, Black Flags and Windmills, which is available here for $15 to $20 sliding scale. But a lot of things I'm going to talk about are not in the book, or at least not in this edition of the book. And it's about, and really what I hope is that we engage in dialogue and really think about how we want to engage in change for the future. The title of my book, Black Flags and Windmills, is a reference to the black flags that anarchists have carried for over 100 years. And the flags that we would burn if we were to ever gain a lot of power, because they don't represent us, they're just a representation of us. And also the fact that I have felt like Don Quixote all my life. People have read Cervantes' Quixote, right? A lot of times I have worked with others to slay giants, real true giants that we have brought down, or corporations that we have brought to their knees, state entities we have brought to their knees. And other times I've been a total jackass and tilted at windmills. We all do it. I think we need to recognize it. It reminds me that we need to be humble in all the work that we do and everything that we engage in. And so in that, everything starts somewhere. For me, it's my politicization really starts in 1985 when I first get in the streets with a bunch of people. I was going to be the first generation of people and my family to graduate from high school. And this is my extended aunts and uncles and stuff. I grew up in a very rural area that was very working class poor. And most of the average education of my family was about 6th to 8th grade. And so it was a lot of pressure for me to stay in high school and to graduate and go on. Well, I ended up quitting and after this big family meeting, and it was my first act of rebellion that I was conscious of that I wanted to do because I knew that they were wrong and I knew the school was wrong, even though I didn't have all the things to go. And I stood up to authority and said, no, that's not right. I want to quit. And it wasn't a flippant thing. I thought about it for a long time. I was actually working in the outside world already, and I saw what the real world was like, and it was not like high school. Anybody else have that experience? Yeah. So I agreed to go to college for about, I said, yeah, I'll go to college if you guys will leave me alone. Because I was going to be a rock star, and I didn't need to go to college to be a rock star. Because that was going to be my ticket out of poverty and out of this area. And you got to dream something, because it's going to get you somewhere. And so that's me rocking a mullet back in 1985 at my first protest of anti-apartheid. And I started there and I saw the power of what we can do as individuals working together to resist oppression, to resist change, to actually work together to do something. Now, we didn't change the system, but we started a movement, or we were part of a movement that really started the divestment campaigns in South Africa. And they went on. But I also started a lifelong work on issues that have stuck with me for the last 25 years. And one of those was animal liberation. I became a vegan and vegetarian in 1985 and started working on animal rights stuff in 1988. And like a lot of people, I came to more politicization, not just through being in the streets, but actually through music. How many people here have come up through music, have really gotten like politicized? I think it's mixed always, but it's a powerful cultural tool. But animal rights. And the second thing that, anyone's going to do that? Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Back. There we go. One more. All right, there's the other one. The other one is environmental concerns. The destruction of our natural planet. Now, I'll say that I didn't all of a sudden come out of the chute as an anarchist. I knew that things were wrong, and I worked with what was around us, with socialists and communists. Where I grew up in Dallas, there was a big chapter of the Black Panther Party that existed in the 60s, and I was working with those people and became friends with those people in the 90s. And I started working on a lot of environmental issues through organizations like Greenpeace. And again, I'm still working within the system and sort of outside the system of protesting, but I'm still trying to change power. I want power to do the right thing instead of figuring out that we can do the right thing. And then the third thing that started back in 1985 was working on political prisoner issues. First through Amnesty International and recognizing that there was international political prisoners, but then starting to realize there was political prisoners in our own backyard and started to work on that. And these are issues that have stuck with me for a long time in many different forms. I've been in tree sits, I've been on blockades, I've written prisoners, I've done prisoner support for a long time in this, as many of you have. But I can't underestimate the power, the influence the Black Panther Party had on me. I'm not a Maoist, but they actually brought to the front a lot of ideas that have really stuck with me and it really started to make sense. The organizing I was seeing going on in the late 80s and all through the 90s was not the organizing that I knew about, because they wanted to build survival programs pending revolution. And also they had these things about self-defense. These were things that were not being talked about. We had gotten so single issues, like union issues over here, animal rights over here, environmental issues over here. And there was no power building that was going on with that, except in those single issue things. And don't jump. Come back. So the Panthers had these survival programs pending revolution, which I thought was a really powerful idea, is that you basically help people get back on their feet, and then they can build political power for themselves. If they ask the question, why is somebody hungry, you can feed them because that's the easy way to do it. But the Panthers said, why are you hungry? Is it because you don't have access to good health care and so you're sick so you can't get to work? Is it because there's no jobs of dignity nearby that will keep you going? Is it because you didn't get a good education because there's no schooling that will help you to get a good job? So they started to look at all these complex ways to do it. And they weren't the only organization that was doing it. There's lots of political organizations that were doing these things, but they spoke to me because I knew a lot of these people who were doing it. It was personal relationships that were telling me these things that they were doing, and it really had an influence on me. And then we go, gosh dang it, it's really messing up now. This is not gonna work. Come on, one more. Back. You guys are being so patient, I love that. So then we go on and the Panthers are destroyed. All the movements of the late 60s and the early 70s begin to go away. All these things are changing. This is not a non-linear history. And then in the 1990s, this group of indigenous people rise up in Chiapas, Mexico and say, ya basta, enough. They didn't want to be crushed. And so what they started to do is they took the ideas of groups like the Black Panther Party of survival programs pending revolution, they just didn't call them that, and started to build it. But they added this other thing and said, we want autonomy. This is our area, and we're going to take it. And so they did, and they started to build these things themselves, first with arms, and then later they put their arms down. But they also added these elements where there was no hierarchy to it. There was no cult leader. There was no one person who was going to lead them out of it. The people's voices were all being shared. It was participatory democracy in each of the communities where we began to share their voices. The other thing is that they didn't say it's 1, 2, 3 steps to revolution. What they said was that we are experimenting with this and we can change it at any time. They became the first postmodern revolution of that we've ever had. And they're still experimenting today. Well, that was pretty powerful stuff to a little redneck guy in Texas. And the ideas of the postmodern revolution, I think, are really important because it's a living revolution. It's a dynamic revolution. And then we start to move up to the late 90s. And come on, work. Don't go to sleep. And I come back to anarchism. And I start to read about people like Emma Goldman. And I start to learn about movements of anarchists that were going on and things that were happening, horizontal organizing. Because I tell you the truth, for me, communism and socialism were failing. They failed, the dictatorial state communist governments were failing, the people in large scales, and largely in the left here, they were failing they were failing our movements because they weren't building mass movements anymore. They were stuck in rigid ideology. And all of a sudden, this dynamic thing of anarchy started to rise up and make a space for itself. And there's the black flags. And it's the ideas of anarchy, of voluntary association, mutual aid, collective liberation, solidarity, autonomy, direct action. The fact that we didn't have to appeal to power to make change, that we could start to build and exercise our power from below. Each and every one of us working together could do these things, were exciting ideas. And then, as the late 90s progressed, let me back up for a second. But there's some common themes that all of these had. That all of these disparate movements have all that I started to synthesize, it started to make sense to me. And what is the idea of autonomy and self-determination? That each community should determine its own future. And that we shouldn't vote for people 3,000 miles away to tell us what we're going to do in our communities, and we shouldn't let corporations exploit us. The ideas of dual power, that we must resist, which is what we do really well, but we must also create and build on the other hand. The ideas of participatory democracy. Gosh dang it, come on y'all. I am really sorry about this. Testing it out. Participatory democracy, which is that all of our voices count. That no leaders are going to take us out of this. That it's all of us working together. Community defense. That we have a right to defend ourselves by any means necessary. That means legal means. That means stopping corporations from polluting in our rivers, in our communities, from extracting resources, from exploiting labor, to armed self-defense if necessary. The ideas that narratives, that we must tell these stories of revolution, that we can create these revolutions, that it's not one day there's a revolution, but they're living revolutions, and that we should all be a part of these things. The other thing that all these disparate movements have done is connected the struggles, all the different things, how do they relate to each other. And so we move forward, and anarchism is starting to rise in the United States in the late 90s. And nobody was caring except these small little pockets, and I was really excited. And then all of a sudden, all these people started gathering in Seattle in 1999 for the World Trade Organization. How many people remember that? Yeah. And there was 50,000 people on the streets. And all of a sudden, we had a movement of movements where you had labor and environmental people working together for the first really overt big time against undemocratic institutions. And there was anarchists that had done a majority of the organizing. They started to use spokes councils and affinity groups models for on a large scale, larger than they had done in the Clamshell Alliance in the 70s. But not many people cared that the WTO was meeting that 50,000 people stood out there to say, no, we're not going to do this, until, back up. This is a disaster. I'm not going to use this anymore. Until somebody put a brick through the Starbucks window. Now, the brick did not solve the problem, but all of a sudden it was mainstream news, and it was the coming out party for anarchism in the United States. And all of a sudden, anarchy had the largest sphere of influence over political organizing. The old left, the old communist left, was beginning to fade away, and these new models were starting to, these not new models, but these re-emerging models started to become popularly used. And the ideas, and you know, like, it was the ideas of street medics, and food, things like food, not bombs, and legal defense teams, convergence spaces, solidarity, general assembly, spokes councils, and affinity groups. And these things, all of these things would happen in this big mass summits that were happening. And how many people participated in those summits, actually? Yeah. It's funny because they faded so fast, but like there was a time when it was like this renaissance was like really like rising up. And it was amazing because not only were people resisting on one hand, but they were creating this autonomous zone in this large scale on this other hand, where you create this space where like all these people could work together, we had all this civil society infrastructure on this small scale, but then it would be gone. Just like everything. And so I start moving along, and the summits start to go away, and I'm always thinking, like, we resist, but how do we build power? And I'm thinking about that. And then a storm came ashore in 2005, Hurricane Katrina. You guys remember Hurricane Katrina? And you recognize that there was three major factors actually that caused the disaster. One is the ecological destruction on the Gulf Coast that existed, had been going on for 100 years to extract oil and to move doodads up and down the Mississippi River. It's important to recognize that. So they destroyed the barrier reefs along the way, and they widened the mouth of the rivers and destroyed the marshes. That has gone on for a long time. The second thing was that the absolute corruption of the government, especially in Louisiana, to not build levees strong enough or get people out of there. And then the third thing was that the federal government's response to the disaster created the disaster. They left tens of thousands of people to die. Now when I say that, I don't mean like 10,001 people, tens of thousands of people to die on the rooftops and in their attics, starve them out, no water, it's 100 degrees outside, and people are trapped in their attics because they were getting in their attics because that's the thing that they could do until the water rose, and then some people could bust through to get to the rooftops, but a lot of people couldn't. You're talking about whole families, you know, women, children, fathers, mothers, uncles, aunts, grandmothers. And people didn't have any resources to get out. There was nowhere to go. And what the government did in its initial response was not to get everybody out and say, we'll do anything that we can to get everybody out of here. What they said was, we will restore law and order. It was criminal neglect. And the storm came ashore on Sunday. On Monday, the levees broke and they declared martial law to restore law and order. And a man named Brandon Darby, who I'd known since 2002, called me and he said, hey, Brock, why don't we go get our friend there? This friend of mine, come on, please work. Oh, back up. There we go. You guys are being so patient. Note to self, do not use this one again.
It is cool, though.
Yeah, it looks great, but it's so buggy. Really? It's just so buggy. All right, let's try one more time. Yeah, it's not going to work. Can you guys give me 2 seconds to switch over really quick? Was that okay? I know it was up to a dramatic point, but just give me a second and I'll switch. It's just too frustrating for me, because I don't want to wrestle with it all night. Thanks for going down the experimental trail with me.
Which program is it?
It's called Prezi.
Oh yeah, Prezi.
Yeah. It works better online. Right? It was like beautiful, like we're there, it's like seamless, right? So but Brandon Darby called me because we were both mutual friends with this man named Robert King. He was part of the Angola 3. Are y'all familiar with the Angola 3? Some of the longest held people in solitary confinement in modern U.S. history. And Robert King had won his just freedom in 2001 and had been living back in New Orleans, which is what he should do because that's where he was from. And these guys were living in 6x9 cells, organizing against prison rape, against sanctioned prison rape, and for better conditions in the 70s, and the most brutal prison in the United States at that time. And because they were Panthers, they had formed the only chapter there, they were set in solitary confinement. They still organized from that. Now, this man, who I loved and had been doing support work for the years previous to his being released and then being released, was trapped there, or at least I thought he was, and we had to find him. So Brandon posited the idea, and I was like, I don't know about this, man. I'm not into rescue, but I really want to find King because I don't want him to die in a flood. I think it would be a travesty because this man had given his life for social justice behind bars. He should be free. The other two men on the other side, Herman Wallace and Albert Woodfox, have been in for 41 years in solitary confinement right now. And so we headed, we decided to head to New Orleans. So we took a couple of guns, boats, and some food and some water, and we were there on Wednesday night. The martial law was declared on Monday, we were there on Wednesday. And what we saw was criminal neglect. 280 boats that by other people who had come, people just like you with these beautiful emergency hearts that said, I want to do something, were turned away by governments because the government could not control the boats. I could see the people trapped on the rooftops. Who gives a shit if you can't control them? Just let us in to get the people. That's all it is. It's a simple arithmetic. And they wouldn't let us do it. So we said, we're going to go in ourselves. So we went around where they weren't controlling it. We went in, we took a little small, does anybody know what a John boat is? Anybody fish? John boat's a little flat bottom boat. Well, two guys with no experience took it out into an open ocean into the storm, fully overloaded with supplies, and went into New Orleans. And this is what we saw. And when I talk about the destruction of New Orleans, and when you see pictures of it, you have to understand it wasn't just New Orleans. It was for hundreds of miles in every direction. And I'm going to tell you this. It is unimaginable, the destruction. Unimaginable. You cannot imagine unless you were there. Because when you see a disaster, if your house catches on fire, you can go to your neighbor's house. That's manageable. If a tornado or an earthquake hits your community, you can go to the next community. But what do you do when the town after town, city after city, for hundreds of miles is gone? It's unimaginable. Everything that we think we know about in the first world was gone. And hundreds of miles for community after, there was nobody to rely on anybody. And a state was killing people inadvertently. So we were going to take this boat out from the open Gulf into that water area right there, into where that levee breaches. You see where the little hole is? That's into the lower Ninth Ward, where that barge had gone through there. Didn't have any idea what we were doing, but we knew we wanted to get to our friend King, who was a little bit further back there in Center City. And it was terrifying. And we had to move fast, and we were helping people along the way because people were stranded all over the place. But I saw two things. I saw chaos on one hand, where people were desperate. But I also saw what I called anarchy, where people with nothing would help each other in mutual aid. I saw people give out the last water bottle, not knowing any water was going to come back to them, to somebody who needed it more than they did. I watched people help each other right and left because it mattered. Not because they could think ideologically, well, does that matter? No, they were like, it matters. I'm going to help you. And see the little house to the left of the barge right there, that little blue house? I want you to pay attention to it because we're going to see it later. And in this time, we failed miserably. I'm going to back up for just one second. We failed miserably in finding King. And I did what I didn't want to do, which it was on Saturday. I was exhausted, and we started to hear reports that rescuers were being shot by people. You could not get any news, right? And the criminalization of black people was starting to happen. Looters, and they were shooting white rescuers, and we couldn't tell if it was true or not. And it was starting to get terrifying. But I knew that I didn't want to shoot somebody to help somebody else. So with a great amount of shame and a lot of guilt, we left. And I say with shame because I'd had this long-standing thing, I had never done it before, where I said that I would never leave anybody behind. And I never had, until that point, and here was with tens of thousands of people. I was ashamed, because I'd used all my privilege to get there. I got home and I was exhausted. And then another former member of the Black Panther Party, a man named Malik Rahim, who had been a longtime organizer, who also lived there, who lived in Algiers, which had not flooded, called me, because I'd been working with him on prison work in the Angle 3 for about 6 or 7 years at that point. And he said, "Hey bro, we need support. There's white militias driving around my community and they're gonna kill me. We need support." And I knew what he meant. I'm from Texas. He meant bring guns. And so we did. And I didn't do it with adventurism. I did it because of 20 years of political organizing brought me to that point. My anti-racist principles, my solidarity with communities that are not mine brought me to that point. And so I said, I'll do it. I was there on Monday. And this is what we started to see when we came back in. We started to see the criminalization of people, where they were starting to arrest looters. Like, you understand, people are still trapped. It's only a week, and people are still trapped on the roofs. They're still trapped in their homes. They have no access to food, no access to water. You saw the flags waving. That's what people were doing. And this is what they were worried about. People taking diapers and water and food. If you were left to die, you should take those things. And if you want to take some liquor and some cigarettes and a big screen TV, more power to you, because you're going to swim across with it, and it's not going to work because there's no electricity. But I'm like, take it. I saw a Walmart getting looted, and I was happy because those people were left to die. And it wasn't just the people were left to die. It was also the police. I saw New Orleans police looting at the Walmart. So it was widespread. People have a right, it's just property, but they wanted to restore that. The other thing I saw was the militarization of the police, of the whole area. Soldiers were coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan, and they were starting to build these sandbag turrets, just like it was an occupation, with 50 caliber guns aimed at people. Who were they going to shoot? The war was on us. Everybody. All the people wanted was help. And when I first got to Malik's, is there any kids? Okay. The first thing that we did was some kids came and got us and said, "Can you help us with this?" And we covered up this bullet riddled dead body. Now, this man was left to die indignantly. His bullets were all through him. I could smell it for 2 blocks before we got to him. Who killed this man? Was it the white militia that was driving around, that looked just like the Ku Klux Klan, without the little stupid hats, but they were drunk in their trucks and meting out justice? White guys were meting out justice in a largely black community? Or was it the police who were also killing people, or we suspected at the time, and now we know we're killing people? We didn't know, but we knew the situation was dire. So we formed our own tactical defense caucus and took up arms. Two white guys and 3 black guys from the neighborhood took up arms to defend those 2 or 3 streets from the white militias. And it was awful and it was scary. And we also took up arms against the police because we were afraid the police were going to kill us. And now, again, everything that we think we know about today is gone. We're not making rational decisions based on all of this. We're making rational decisions in a disaster area that you can't imagine, right? And then, but out of that turmoil, out of that, came this thing. I've been thinking, what would the Black Panther Party have done? What would Zapatistas do in this? What would I do as an anarchist? And what could we do as anarchists? And 3 people, Malik Rahim, who I talked about earlier, Sharon Johnson, who's somebody you never hear about in the narrative except in my book, who was a bookkeeper before the storm and became an awesome organizer, and my old knucklehead self started this organization and we called it the Common Ground Collective. And the idea was really simple. It was to help build infrastructure that had never existed in these communities, and to rebuild infrastructure that had gone in the long, slow history of disaster before the storm got there. And the thing is, we weren't going to come in and tell people how it was going to be. We would go into the communities and ask them what they were doing, what the Zapatistas call lead by obeying. And we wanted to rebuild infrastructure, healthcare, education, food security, all of these pieces that take us to build the basics for living, basically, so people can build their political power to determine their own futures. Because the large nonprofit industrial complex and the government was not going to do it. These people were going to do it themselves, and we were going to help them do it. And we started to tell the story of revolution, and thousands of people just like yourselves started to come. People whose emergency hearts, these beautiful, passionate things that we have that tell us that we want to make change, that we want the world to be better for all of us, came because it was important and an important time to do it. Their emergency hearts were pumping in overdrive, and thousands of people came. We started with 3 people and $50, and we in the first 3 years, we had 28,000 people come through just like yourselves. Who wanted to do something, who wanted to be a part, who were willing to risk all of these horrible things to make this happen. And it was pretty amazing. And we started with distribution. And then within the first 15 days, we had a clinic. And it was all based on the ideas that all the anarchist organizing I had been doing for the last few years. So could street medics start a clinic? Could a clinic become a hospital? Could food not bombs come and start to feed people in the short term and then build long-term supportable kitchens? Could we build worker co-ops? All these questions were rolling around in my head when I pitched these ideas and we just started to build it. And then when people like yourself started to come, more and more ideas started to come. And we would go into the communities and we would just ask them, what do you need? Because unlike the Red Cross, which came in and said, this is the way it's going to be everywhere. It was like a franchise. Everybody got the same thing. We said, what do you need? What do you want? How do we help you? And then those people, some people wanted self-defense for their communities. Other people wanted, they wanted help with their houses. Some people wanted their tree services. All of these things, like service work. But we also provided legal aid. But we also, we would break the law. We would use basic civil disobedience to ignore the laws. Now, remember, there are some lawyers here, right? But all laws are bureaucratic, arbitrarily, and are bureaucratic, reactionary, and selectively enforced. And so, what the thing is, we used our ethics, the way that we felt was right, that we knew was right to help these communities, and we occupied a house in the lower ninth ward. And when they arrested the first amount of people there, more volunteers from Common Ground put themselves in there. People took their privilege to say, we can risk arrest for these communities that can't do it. And the violence that we had to face as volunteers, you have to understand that those communities faced it for decades and for hundreds of years, some of them. So we just got a small taste of that. And the state did not like that we were breaking the laws. And so there was a lot of repression around it, Homeland Security and NOPD. We were invited to this house and we stayed. And then Common Ground volunteers put their bodies on the line to stop scummy landlords from evicting people from their houses and from the state from destroying houses. Not just public housing, but individual houses also. You have to understand that when they finally started to get people out, there was a huge diaspora, right? Do y'all know about this? They just started putting people in Texas and Idaho and Kansas and Maine, and with no way that they were figuring out how they're going to get back. So people couldn't even get back to check their houses. And you have to understand about New Orleans is there's intergenerational housing that's been passed down for hundreds of years sometimes. And they don't pass a deed down. It just goes from your mama to your mama's mama to your mama's mama to your daddy to your cousin. And you just pass it on down. The families just live in that. And those houses were not valuable for the storm. Well, now they are valuable to land speculators. So we said, you can't tear them down. Until the people come back and decide. And people lock themselves down to things. The other thing that we did was, and when I say the we, I want you to understand that I wasn't there standing on the front lines for all of this. I just helped the spark the organization and get it going and build the foundations for it. I wasn't even there the whole time. But thousands of people like you were. And more people came. And we just kept doing things. But one of the things that we did was that kids were, in 2006, kids wanted to come back to their school, at the Martin Luther King School, and the school said it would cost $3 million to open the school. And so they said, we can't do it. And we're like, that's not going to cost $3 million. We were gutting houses right and left. We had gutted thousands of houses there. We knew we could do it. We had a volunteer labor force. We had the tools. And so we used our privilege, cut the locks on the doors in front of the police, and walked in and started cleaning up the school. And now the school exists with the students that were there. And it was a beautiful thing, and that it became an exemplary school. There's the gutting. Oops, let's back up. If y'all have another battery, I would take it. AAA. And so basically with the ideas of direct action, mutual aid, organizing, and outreach, we created neighborhood assemblies, communication centers, health clinics, legal support, eviction defense. We created a women's center, free schools, gutted houses, food security, community defense, aid distribution, cop watch, service work, civil disobedience, and food not bombs. But we did hundreds of programs within this thing. We could have 5,000 volunteers on the street at any given time. And we were building and we were resisting at the same time, dual power. And it wasn't always perfect. AAA? I just need one. Sorry, my battery died. And it wasn't always perfect. I would love to sit here and tell you, like, yes, it was all fantastic. We were all doing staff infection was common. People were sick. There was a crisis, a top 10 list of crisis, and everything was number one. We were underfunded, even though we raised a lot of money, we were underfunded, understaffed. We were trying to rebuild the infrastructure of civil society, which was an impossible dream, but that's how we had to start. The other thing is that we brought all the baggage and all the problems with us, because even as anarchists, as radicals, as socialists, as communists, as organizers in the political sphere, even though we had dreamed of this beautiful world, we still are bringing all the issues of privilege with us, all the issues of oppression with us. And one of the things that happened was we inadvertently created a hierarchy of oppression where race was first, class was second, and gender and sexual orientation, they just fell off the map most of the time. We didn't want it to be that way. We consciously worked to not have it that way, but that's the way it happened. And it's one of the biggest mistakes that we had there. And it was one of the things I wish that we could change. We had a lot of strong women in leadership that were doing amazing things, but there's still this element element of subtle sexism in the organization. Women were raped there, but no more or less than the general population. Our organization was open to everybody. So when residents were coming back, we had no control of that. And we had to deal with it outside of the state. So we had to resort to violence to do it. And it didn't always feel good. And with all the police run-ins and everything, I suffered from post-traumatic stress for 5 years from it. And I could leave that place because my home wasn't destroyed. What about the people who had to suffer that for decades? I think about that. And Common Ground started to change. Oh, it's going away. It's not working. I got no power in that one. It started to change in about 2008, and we decided to make it more of a traditional nonprofit. And it started to follow the traditional nonprofit model. All right, now this is getting exhausted. Hey y'all, this normally doesn't happen, I promise. But I want to talk about, like, three people started it. There were some key organizers who did a lot of great work, and one of them was Liz Zaffiti. And has anybody part of the Occupy New York at all? I worked with Lisa on anything. She was a critical organizer. You never heard of her. We did a lot of stuff. But there's a lot of other good people who did stuff. And these are some of the key organizers that did a lot of things along the way. And Common Ground still exists today. It's much smaller than it was then, right? People went on to other things. We had Common Ground volunteers go to Haiti. A lot of people went to Haiti. And we start to influence a lot of movements. I mean, one of the things that we did I'm the most proud of is we had anti-racist trainings for 5,000 to 10,000 white middle-class students from all over the country who came to that, with the People's Institute, who started anti-racist trainings in this country back in 1970. And so we helped them get back on their feet, and they helped help kids gain political analysis. So Common Ground tries to restore the grasslands and the wetlands in the Gulf Coast and do a bunch of things. And our headquarters their headquarters, because I'm not part of it anymore. It's hard not to. That's the house that you saw earlier. And it's a beautiful thing. It's permacultured all around it, and it's part of a growing community around it. Well, there's a high cost to pay for a lot of this stuff. In 2006, I had been visiting Herman Wallace of Angola 3 for about 5 years in prison. I was unceremoniously kicked off of his list. And it's funny because the reason that I found out I was kicked off is because I was listed as an animal rights extremist, environmental extremist, and a domestic terrorist. Now, it was funny that they were calling me an environmental terrorist because I was standing at Home Depot buying uncertified lumber at the time. And I was like, oh, I wish they could see this. I'm just buying wood. That's what I do, right? So, but I started, all the repression had been going on for a long time. But here's the thing. It was like a Kafka-esque tale, right? I knew that this was happening because the FBI had told the lawyer for the Angola 3, but I could do nothing about it. Well, I'd already known because I was not able to fly. I already knew that because they were sitting in front of my house for 3 years, not just the FBI, it was Joint Terrorism Task Force, there was Sheriff's Department, there was the police, and all these things started were happening, but I couldn't defend myself. I was like, if they had indicted me, I was able to go to court and I could defend myself. I was like, bring it, come on, y'all, let's do it. And they never did it. It was a whisper campaign. And so what was happening all those years as I was getting pulled over by the police, they were terrified of me. It's because they said I was armed and dangerous and I had a predication for violence. Never been arrested for a violent act in my life. Not even charged with it. And they said, and so like these officers would pull over and they'd be like terrified of me. Or like, get out of the car. I'm like, why are you even pulling me over? Because I have to, you know? And so I was labeled a terrorist that I knew of. And so I started to think about it. Like, I want you to know that when I know that this was happening, I'm a paper tiger. I'm not some badass person that was doing all of these things. I'm just like you. I'm just a person who's struggling along to do these things. But I fit the profile of what they were doing because I started to really think about it. Who have they been targeting? Who are my friends who have been targeted over the, and so the people in this room that you know. And then who are my friends who went to prison over the last few years? I started to see a lot of my friends going to prison. And so I started to talk about, I want to shift gears and talk about the war on terror and what a farce it is. I know, does anybody here think it's not a farce? Thank you. But who are the main targets of it? Well, largely it's Muslim communities and people of Middle Eastern descent. 99% of the cases, that's what it is. In political circles, we don't pay attention to that very often, but that's the communities that are under siege from it. Of the over 500 cases, 498 of them have to do with people of Middle Eastern descent at some level. But the other groups are animal rights and environmental groups and individuals, and then political activists in general get the low-level harassment, the overt surveillance and stuff, but anarchists in particular, because most of the people in the animal liberation and earth liberation movements who are in prison also self-identify as anarchists or are anarchist-affiliated. And well, I was in three of the categories. I was in two of the categories. Guess which one I was not? And so I started to think about this. And started doing research about it. And so the war on terror is the greatest bureaucracy that the government has created in a long time, right? Since they did the Department of Defense. And it's on its way to try to rival that. That's what their goal is. The U.S. intelligence budget is $75 billion a year. They created or reassigned or created 4,000 new agencies in the war on terror. They're taking money out of the war on drugs and putting it into the war on terror. They're taking these agencies instead of the Joint Terrorism Drug Force or whatever it was called, it's now the Joint Terrorism Task Force. The other thing is 854,000 new jobs, which that's actually about a million now, because these figures are about a year old. There's Obama's job package right there. Think about that. And most of the cases, informants are used, not always provocateurs, but informants. And this is from Mother Jones from about a year ago. Of the 500 cases, 243, 48% were targeted with an informant in there. All the electronic stuff that we worry about is minuscule compared to how much an informant's going to tell. In 158 of the cases, 31% were arrested in a sting where the FBI set it up with an informant. And then in 49 cases, which actually I think that's about 54 cases now, 10% were nabbed by an informant who led the plot. That is their MO right now. That is the way that they do it. And now, actually just came out that there was only about 3 cases that didn't involve an informant at all. Remember the guy who had the one in his shoe? Y'all remember that guy? And then the guy had it in his underwear? And then it was the Times Square bomber? Those are the 3. Well, guess what? It just came out that the guy who put it in his underwear was an informant working for the CIA. So that brings it down to 2 cases out of over 500 cases that have been tried since 2001. The war on terror is a war on us. Not just political activists, but us, our civil liberties, all of us. And the civil liberties I'm talking about are not just the Constitution, because I believe our innate right to live free. And it's not just governments, though. It's also corporations. Corporations are making money on this hand over fist, right? There's private security firms that sell information to governments. They sell information to other corporations under security threats. And security threats like Indie Media. Does anybody remember Indie Media? Mm-hmm. That was a big security threat that Stratford listed. But they also have this revolving door where if you're working for the FBI, you might start out at $30,000 or $40,000 a year. But you could leave the FBI, go work for Halliburton or KBR, and come back and work for the FBI as a contractor and be making making $70,000 or $80,000 a year or $100,000 a year. And KBR's making money on top of that, or Halliburton's making money. There's money to be made all the way around. And we always talk about the things that the government, how much the government spies on us, but we don't talk about how much corporations spy on us, right? How many people are carrying a tracking device on them? That's nice, you recognize it. How many people carry a smartphone on it? That's pretty good. It's a tracking device, right? I'm not saying it's nefarious, but it just is. So Google knows where we are, Apple knows where we are, Twitter knows where we are, Facecrack knows where we are. And it's a revolving door because these guys are going back and forth. Who knows about WikiLeaks? Who knows about Anonymous? If anybody here is part of either one of those, I love you! Love you! Thank you for releasing. Transparency makes things important. In 2004, before Facebook existed, a friendly person released corporate documents that had been gathered on a few of us who had been organizing against ExxonMobil, and they called it the ExxonMobil Facebook. And basically, what it had was people who had protested against ExxonMobil or Halliburton over between 2003 and 2004. They gathered incredible amounts of information, and somebody released that information to us. And I was super happy about it. Now, the thing is, we can do Freedom of Information Act requests with the government, and we may get limited documents, but we have a chance to get something. There's some amount of transparency. Corporations, you never know what they're going to gather. This is nefarious stuff, in my opinion. I'm not even talking about the tacit stuff that they gather. So, and it's a revolving door. So in my case, they collected 12,000 pages from 2001 to 2008. They investigated me in 13 field offices in 9 states. I guess the other thing is I had 5 informants since 2001. I can name some of them. One of them was a man named Brandon Darby. You guys remember I mentioned him earlier? Two friends of mine went to prison, and another friend of mine is dead because of Brandon Darby. And he tried to put me in prison in 2006 by getting me to burn down a bookstore in Austin, and I didn't go for it. And he's a complicated story because he got a lot of protection from being friends with me. And because of my emotional state and post-traumatic stress that we both had from things that we went through in New Orleans together, I still gave him pause. And then until he came out as an informant to turn my eyes, you know, to revert some of the things, some of the sexist behavior that he had, the misogynist behavior, and I'm really sorry for that. If I could change it, I would, but I can't because that's the way it was and the sorting out of that. But 5 informants gathering information. One of the informants was a woman who just disagreed with us in Houston because of the militancy of the campaign that we were engaged in against a company. She didn't like it, so she went to the FBI and started giving information. So all the security culture that we had used to have these covert names and all this stuff and all these things didn't matter because she was feeding all that information to the FBI. They knew all the nicknames that we had. They knew every communique, who wrote it. You know, and but I was under incredible amounts of surveillance, covert surveillance, which I didn't even know about at the time, like my tax records. They tried to get the IRS to go after me, but I learned from the Panthers, you pay your taxes because you don't want to go out like that. You pay your library fines too, and then all the covert stuff where they sat in front of my house. I couldn't fly with TSA. They were coming to my work. They were coming to my an organization I had started called Treasure City Thrift. They were coming. They were coming to my house, and because they kept saying I had a predicate for violence, they were going to send the SWAT team after me. They kept threatening because I wouldn't come talk to them. They kept threatening, we're going to send the SWAT team, we're going to send the SWAT team. And I can tell you that it messed with my head. I slept with a gun under my pillow for the first year I came back from New Orleans. And I say that because I don't know what the heck I was thinking. Like, how I was going to respond. Later, somebody was like, why don't you just carry a camera? I was like, oh, that's a good idea. But it never occurred to me, right? I was under siege. I was under siege mentality. And they did pen registers and track and trace. So they looked at all my, they didn't look at the content of my email, but they looked at all the emails and all the internet places that I went. And they did trash covers, too. They went through all that stuff and found that we had catalogs. Because I had housemates. I had a lot of people. So they found catalogs and all kinds of bullshit in there. All my known relations were investigated, and all these documents, it's great to see all these pictures of all my friends, because I'm like, oh, that's a family of people that I love. They subpoenaed all my utilities. I was investigated by the IRS. They visited all the threats of grand juries. I was randomly searched at the airport every time from 2002 to 2006 when I stopped flying. I just stopped because I couldn't get on planes anymore. I was like, okay. Because I would go there and they would go like, they wouldn't say like, you know, we're just going to talk to you. They're like, we don't know if you can get on this flight. That's pretty intimidating. So you run into that enough and just stop flying. And information was shared between the private security and the other ones. So what I learned from this and from the cases of my friends who have gone to prison and the whole Quintel Pro history and all of these things are some things that I would like to share with you. Informants are their best source. And it's not always the people like Brandon Darby who are provocateurs. I look at them as a different source, but people who are gathering information. Agencies are taking in too much information to develop critical analysis around it. They can't tell what a right-wing group says about you and what you say about yourself. They give them the same weight. And I find that really interesting. They push a lot of duplicate and redundant paperwork. And all the documents, I've seen tens of thousands of pages of FOIA documents, they push a lot of stupid paperwork. There's a lot of paper pushing going on just to justify your job for 60 grand a year. And intelligence information gathered is really wide, but not very deep. When they get down to people like, when they investigate people like me, the reason my case is an anomaly is because I'm standing here today, and I'm not in prison. Because when they go that far, they want to get a conviction. They convened 3 grand juries to indict me, and they couldn't indict me. They tried to get me for arson in 9 states related to the ELF and the ALF for stockpiling weapons. I'm from Texas, man. Everybody's got guns. Yeah. Even little babies got guns. And then also being a nexus of terrorism because they said I was taking money from international sources and funneling it to domestic terrorist cause. Now, when I read that, I was like, that guy sounds scary. And I was like, that's me, you know? I was like, and the thing is, I make light of it now, but it's terrifying to read. But when I got all the documents, all of this stuff had been happening in the past for about 10 years. And it started before, in the 90s, because of the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act. That was the first time. There had been some low-level vandalism that happened in the Dallas area where I was living, against fur stores and stuff. And that I was visited at my work by an FBI agent, and the first time I ever heard the words domestic terrorism and animal rights together. And it's because they were trying to equate vandalism and property destruction with terrorism. So it was there. So they have little understanding of horizontal decentralized policies or politics or organizing structures. They do really sloppy investigative work. I'll give you a quick example. My partner and I have been together for 25 years. They give a physical description of her and a physical description of myself, and then the agent says, they don't look like they go together. Another case, Robert King of the Angola 3, who speaks internationally, travels and does 200 events a year speaking internationally, has been received by the ANC and all these parliaments around the world, has been on CNN and all major news outlets, and says every time, I was a prisoner in Angola prison. He says it clearly. And in my documents they say, this man, Robert King, says he was in prison. We can find no records of that. Took them 2 years to figure it out. The other thing is, even with the vast resources that we think of, we think the state is all-powerful. They are not all-powerful. They do have limits to the resources because the agencies, the multi-agencies, are fighting for the same damn funds. And the people in the war on terror are fighting against the people in the war on drugs for the same damn money. Right? And so they're all trying to fight for it. So they when they do deep investigations, they want to get convictions because that's how they justify their budgets. Not the near misses or the shoulda, woulda, couldas, the convictions. That is why I said. And then the revolving door, we'll go back to that. Well, why do they do this? To maintain power, right? We can agree on that. And when I talk about power, I'm talking about capital P power. Cultural, economic, ecological power over what they consider the rest of us. We don't have to give them that power, but they want to maintain the power that they have in the little fiefdoms. The second thing is money, which also relates to power. There's lots of money to be made in the war on terror, just like there was lots of money to be made in the war on drugs. Have y'all noticed the militarization of your police departments? Yeah, you've noticed the expansion of the prisons? Have you noticed that drones are being used in the United States? Who are they just doing that because they like it? No, they're doing it because they're making money on it. Corporations are selling stuff hand over fist, billions and billions of dollars of equipment to the US government at all levels. And people are eating it up, whether they need it. Barney Fife out and Andy, you know, Andy Griffith out in rural, you know, rural sheriff somewhere in some small podunk town, they now wear flak jackets and all kinds of stuff. Why? So they can lock up the town drunk? Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it's the militarization of the police. And the biggest one is fear. Social control. Because if we are afraid as political movements, if we are afraid as individuals, if we are afraid as concerned citizens, we will do nothing. We will sell ourselves short. We will say this is the only way because this is the accepted way to resist power, to resist authority. But what I will say to you is do not be afraid. I'll say it again, do not be afraid. I'm not saying that we don't be scared because this stuff is scary. But you cannot be afraid to say, we want everything and we want to take it now, or we are going to build it from below. That is our prerogative. We cannot let fear hold us back to say, well, we don't want to do that because we might get in a little bit more trouble. If we want revolutionary change in this country, if we want for a planet not to die on our watch, for us, non-human animals, and the environment, then build.
We must not be afraid.
Oh, get out of there. Go, 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 go! All right, so movements beyond fear. We're going to bring it to the next section. Don't be afraid. We already talked about the counterterrorism complex is a large, bloated, inefficient bureaucracy. That works in our favor. It doesn't sound like it does, but think about it. They can't. The right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. How do we use that in our favor? Our worst fears only happen to a few people. If we look at our friends, our loved ones, the people who have gone to prison in the more recent times, not the political struggles of the 60s and the 70s, but the ones today in the 80s and the 90s. Alright, we're just going to take the 2000s. How about that? It's a very small percentage of all the people who are organizing. It's a very small percentage of the people who are activists. So we must remember that, put it in a context, because the fear of going to prison is scary. And what's the worst thing that could happen? If we really want revolutionary change, if we really want to do these things, we want to exercise power from below, not take state power, but build our own power, is that they can kill us or they can put us in prison. And some of us aren't going to make it. And that's okay. That's part of revolutionary struggle. So remember, remain calm. It can be scary when you're targeted. What's happening to Leslie and Teresa is scary. It's terrifying. It disrupts your life. But that's where we step in to give support to these people and talk about it in public. And don't hide in shadows of it. That we are proud of who we are. That we are proud of our movement. And that we will give these people support because we love them. And what they're doing is out of great love. Solidarity, reach out and support those targeted, especially communities beyond radical subculture. So this is where you want to reach out to Muslim communities and people of Middle Eastern descent. How many people know about the Holy Land Five? How many people correspond or have given support to the Holy Land Five? Thank you. Thank you. Two of those guys are friends of mine that I worked with in the 90s. They do not deserve to be in prison. But nobody in mostly white activist culture is doing anything to support them. We must support them. The people with terrorism labels are in the most severe solitary confinement, the CMUs. They don't even get to talk to the outside world, only through a CIA agent. Andy Stepanian's written about it. Daniel McGowan, who's just been released, just wrote about it. We need to be conscious to support communities outside of ours who are under attack. Practice appropriate security culture. How many people know about security culture here? How many people practice security culture? Be careful. Because we're not gatekeepers. 99% of the work that we do is above ground, and we don't need security culture. We need to hide in plain sight. The fact that we make connections outside of ourselves is really, really important. And, you know, don't let the state divide us. There is no good protester or bad protester. We are just against the system. We will resist and rebel. All of us. Together or none of us. It's the diversity of tactics. And bad behavior is bad behavior. If you're in groups and you have people who are acting out, it doesn't matter whether they're an informant for the state or they're just psychologically out of their mind. Kick them out of your group. Don't try to figure out who they're working for. Just kick them out. And I don't mean that in a flippant way. Like if they're continuing causing problems, it's important to say, you must go somewhere else. Your interests are not the same as ours. You must create safe spaces for ourselves. And I've done it on the good side, and I've done it on the not so good side. And don't believe the hype. Facebook, Apple, and Twitter knows more than the state. Those guys have got it way down, way, way better. The good thing is that they're fighting to sell the information to the state. So be careful about that. And attend and know your rights trainings. I know y'all do that. Support diversity of tactics and movements. Like I talk, it's going to take all kinds of tools to make change. Whether you agree with them or not doesn't matter. But don't condemn people, especially publicly, for their tactics. Maintain transparency. The idea that hide in plain sight. Look. When all this stuff is going down for me, Because I knew the guy who ran the corner store, the people at the gas station, and all my neighbors and stuff, I was a real person to them. I wasn't just an activist. I wasn't just some guy that they saw slinking around. I was a neighbor. I was a brother. I was a father. I was a son. I was multiple people to all these people. I was a real person, and they wanted to give me support. They're like, what do you need help with? So we must maintain relationships with people outside of our political movements. And lawyer up. Are there any lawyers in the house? Yeah, that's right. We need lawyers because that's what the state understands. So you know what? Use it as a tool. Lawyer up and get lawyers if you need stuff. Find friendly lawyers and use the media. A lot of activists and political movements that were like, the corporate media always gets it wrong and grassroots media, we can't get it out there. Use both of them. It works powerfully. I got the New York Times to do three things. One, say positive things about anarchism, even if they got it wrong. Two, to make me sound like a reasonable and rational person. And three, to make the FBI look like jackasses. And I worked on that with the corporate media for 10 months for that story to break about that. And it really helped to spark a debate about spying on public citizens. So it's important to use the corporate media and be careful in how you use it. And keep organizing for liberation. All right, so last piece. What's next? Creating power from below and rethinking our movements. So, one of the things that we do is we have a politics of opposition. We know what we're against. We have a list, it's a laundry list that's giant of all the things we're against. But how many people know what they're for? Right? So I'm gonna propose that we start to use a framework that of the ideas of dream the future and start, we need to start to articulate what are we for and how do we want to get there? Because dreaming the future is important. What do we want our children to grow up in? What do we want to live in? How do we want to live sustainably and locally and all of these ways that we do things? And how do we do it together? Dream this impossible future. It's okay if it's far away. I'm not talking about sci-fi off the planet, but right here. Because this is the planet we live on. This next thing is to know your history. You know, it's not only marginalized communities who have had their history stolen. Anybody in this country has had your history stolen. And it's important for us to reclaim our histories. And you know, like, all my life I'd heard George Washington was somebody as a white male that I had the most in common with, and I'm sure we all heard that story. But when I found out about John Brown, I'm like, I have more in common with that guy than I do with George Washington. And I think it's an important distinction. And the thing is, and as political movements, we also have a tendency to forget that things came before us. Everything that we do was done before. We didn't invent the wheel. We just reinvented it and changed it and changed it and changed it. And we recognize that we're part of this history. Know your history. And it doesn't, and I don't mean the minutia of like whether the fight in 1890 between the communists and the anarchists was really relevant. That doesn't matter. But I'm talking about knowing our movement history for strategies. The next thing is organize our people. And that's the thing that we do really well. Continue to organize it. Organize for liberation. And the last thing is to fight to win. Don't be afraid and start saying, we want it all. We've got to stop fighting for breadcrumbs, y'all. Who wants the? I mean, we don't want breadcrumbs. We want the factory that makes the bread. And if they're not going to give it to us, we're going to take it. And if we don't take it, we're going to create our own. And either way, we are going to control that machine and dismantle it and make it into something much more healthy for all of us. We're going to bust through that. So one of the things that I think is really important to think about is why do you do what you do? You know, when people ask you this, you should know that. We know that that's the core, the heart of what we do. Why do we do what we do? We know how we do it. We protest and write letters and appeal to power, whatever we do, build permaculture, things like that. And we know what we do, but why do we do it? Think about that. Why do you get up in the morning to do these things and start to shape your strategies around that? So here's some ideas. Figure out what we're for. Make long-term strategies. Because I would argue that sometimes just reacting is not the best thing to do. That we have limited resources amongst us, time, people, and money, right? Can anybody disagree with that we don't have limited resources? Yeah, so we need to allocate those things to things that are effective for ourselves. And so sometimes that means doing nothing. Everybody knows shit is bad. We don't need to educate people that shit's bad. We don't need to tell people. Everybody knows that stuff's bad in so many ways. So don't think that, well, we're going to educate the public. Well, you might educate the public to a degree, but everybody knows stuff's bad. Offer an alternative to that. And then start to make strategies for it. And we don't need to protest everything. What if we saved up all of our energy to have a general strike one day? Like, we didn't protest 500 protests in a year. We had one, and we shut the system down. Think about it. I'm not even advocating for it, but I'm just saying, just think about it. And act, don't just react. Dual power. Back to that thing again. Every action that we take must resist on one hand, which we do really well, but it also must create and build on the other hand. If it doesn't do that thing, then don't do it. If you cannot say to your group, to yourself, that this does both of those things, then don't do it. And then think beyond activism. I am not an activist. I am, that pigeonholes me into a small little corner that I refuse to be in. I am a neighbor, a father, a worker. Activism is something that I do. How you doing? And it's something that we do. Don't pigeonhole. We are more than that. We are more complex social beings than that. Oh, come on. Don't do this. All right, shift culture. We need to start to tell ourselves new stories. If we're dreaming the future and we're starting to think about these things, start to tell ourselves new narratives. It's not all about struggle. It's about love. It's about all of these things. And let's start to tell ourselves new narratives and then start to tell everybody else about these new narratives to make them excited about it. And then recognize that if you're in this game for a long time, that we will be, if we are more than voters, and we are more than consumers, and we're to go for these paths in the middle that we don't even know what they are, that we will build the road by walking together. And I think that's really, really important to think about, that we must take chances. It's something the postmodern revolutions and the Zapatistas has showed to me, and I think it's important for us to think about that we will create new paths for that. And it's okay if we make mistakes along the way. And be kind to ourselves along the way. I'm sorry this is so dark. I wasn't prepared to use this PowerPoint. And we need to learn to be kind to ourselves along the way. Ease up on the theoretical sectarian fighting. Unless you're just really into it. And then get onto a chat forum. Really, I mean, we're at our heart, all of us are in this together. And the thing is, when I want to talk about we're all in this together, it's not that I want us all to get into one big boat together. Because that's the problem that we're in now, is that we try to build these big tents or these big boats and say, look, everybody with all these spectrum of politics, let's all get together and go towards this. No, that's not what I'm saying. The dreams that we have are on the shore over there, right? And that's the ideas of liberty and freedom and democracy and the things that we really believe in, whatever you articulate. And that imagine instead of one big boat where we don't get along with each other and that we have all this infighting and things, what if we start to have lots of boats and we all agree to head towards there together? And some people are going to have little skiffs and some people are going to have big armadas, but the idea is you don't sink each other's boats along the way. And some people are not going to make it to the horizon. And we will remember those people who struggled, who didn't do that. And we will, but most of us are going to make it, and we're going to make it on our own time. That is the revolutionary world I want to propose for us. And the strategic alliances and mutual aid and solidarity built in getting all those boats across the water. And if you're in this, if your heart is in this, your emergency heart is this beautiful, beautiful thing, we must take care of it. We must do everything with strategy and keep it sustainable. If you want to be here for a long time, if you want to be in the struggle, if you want to be in the love for a long time, keep it sustainable. Now, I don't mean like ecologically sustainable, for yourselves, because we face burnout a lot, and keep it sustainable. So I'm going to end it with this. Don't give up, don't give in, don't give up, resist, rebel, create, and build. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. I know it was a long presentation, made longer by the technical difficulties. I really appreciate y'all sitting through it so nicely. I guess we'll open it up for questions, comments, concerns. If anybody has any challenges, ideas, poetry.
Well, I have a question.
Okay.
Thank you. This is like just going back to Facebook. Using Facebook for organizing and stuff, what do you like?
It doesn't bother me at all.
A little bit more, like.
Look, am I going to organize an ALF action with Facebook? No. I'm not going to organize an ALF action at all. But you know what? You're holding a fundraiser at, you know, burning books. Well, hell yes, I'm going to use Facebook. It would be silly not to. I mean, I might as well live under a rock, right? If I want people to come, I have to reach people where they are at. right? And I'm going to use all kinds of things. The thing is, we're not living in some secret society. One of the things I've seen in thousands of documents is, I told you about the informants outing people. That's the biggest thing. That's how they find information. Way more than that. They say they're looking at social media, but they don't have enough analysts to look at all the social media and make all the connections. Facebook, how many people here, like, we always talk about how much Facebook gathers information on us. How many people see the ads on the side, and how correct are those ads? They don't have it down yet either. I'm not saying that they won't towards the future, but you can't be afraid. You know, we need the face-to-face contact, we need the telephone, we need the old form of email. Otherwise, we're just going to be writing letters to each other to get people to things. I'm not a proponent of Facebook, but I would say it's a tool, and just use it. And don't be afraid of it. You know, my whole thing is that we're entering this digital age that is different than anything that we knew before. And although I think that Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg in particular are probably evil, and allegedly evil, can I say that? we are entering something that I'm exploring and thinking about, that the new digital age is, it might be different in the way that we engage with our information. Right, like Facebook is pushing us to be much more public, but we are willingly going there, and that says something about us as social animals. And I don't know what that says about us, because I'm not smart enough to think about that, but I think about that, and there might be a time to hide in plain sight. And when I say hide, we're not really hiding, we're just being amongst all the people. And when they have billions and billions and billions of bits of data, you're hiding, because they can't even sort through all that stuff. So I'm not saying that's the way it is, but I'm just saying we could think about it as an idea. Anybody else? Questions coming? You, and then I'll give you.
I wonder if you could talk a bit more on strategies for trying to pull information from and oppose the move that's shifting towards kind of gray area information in a way that corporations are getting up front with smearing and creating that criminality so that they basically set up the targets and sell these targets back to the state.
Yeah. So, but what's the question in that? I'm sorry.
The question is just strategies, because there's a lot of strategies. So you can do your FOIAs, and you can build broad-based solidarity and coalitions across movements.
Sure.
Like that. But it's really hard at this point right now to fight against that corporate strategy of the era of the gray area of information.
I think that's I appreciate that question. It's something that I think that we must recognize that we're in a culture war. I know the right wing has used this, but it's true. And we're in a culture war, and we are losing in some ways. We're quote winning because what we're talking about are things that are rational and reasonable and loving to a lot of people. But we're losing in that way that they're hiring PR firms to do these things, as well as the global security companies and stuff like that. So what I treat it as is propaganda. So. And an example is in the Battle of the Story. Does people know about the idea about the Battle of the Story, where you help to create the story to tell a narrative that helps to support your ideas? It's smart.
It only works for people that listen.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's true. Now I'm not talking about with individuals, but when I engage with the New York Times, most activists are going like, I'm not going to waste any time with the New York Times. They're going to say bad things about anarchists. They're going to say bad things about you. But what I said was, I'm going to take a chance to actually try to develop a relationship with this person to actually make sure that my point gets across. And because even if they get mostly wrong, they get enough of it right. So, but the way I think about it, and I think the way that we should always engage it is the propaganda war. Because that's the way the PR firms are going to. They're going to say all kinds of smeary things about us that are untrue. Like, when I, what I'm telling you.
They
like,
call it propaganda.
When they were saying that I would stop pounding weapons, when they were saying these things, right? Like, some of that stuff comes from corporate America saying this, right? Like, where you're talking about the security firms. And I think it's important to go back after them and ways that engage them in, like, with over-the-top stuff for them. Breitbart, does anybody pay attention to Breitbart News at all? That's what they engage in against their right-wingers that engage in this also. And they use corporate dupes to help all of this. I think just use it as your group, that we must engage corporate media as well as grassroots media. But we also, I think, it's really important to control our own narratives. As individuals and groups and as movements, I think that we need to create better narratives and make sure that we get those out there. And so if it's a culture war, how do you talk to people? Like YouTube, you know, it's not just flyers, it's not just protests. It's like, how else do you reach people? You reach them through YouTube, you reach them through fake social media, you reach them through all these different ways, and use all of these ways to tell our message. The other thing is maintain connections with people outside of our political movements. Make our work relevant to the people who are around us, right? If it's not relevant to the sister and the brother on the block, to the person at the gas station, then we need to stop doing it because we're wasting our damn time. If we can't make a connection with that, what are we doing? We're doing it for ourselves so we can feel good? I don't need to feel good about that. I want to build political power, not for myself, but for all of us to do it, right? So engaging in propaganda is what I would say. I mean, we battled these guys. Stratfor was out of, does anybody know about Stratfor? They're the ones who put those documents together. I don't know if did I mention that? They're the ones who put those documents together. And then Jeremy Hammond released, you know, thousands and thousands of emails recently. We need people like that who will stand up and do that stuff. We need people in Anonymous and in WikiLeaks who will make these things transparent that refuse to be transparent. I think that's the other way to battle it, because it exposes them and shows how bad that they are. Because people didn't even know about these security firms 10 years ago, but now it's widespread news. So there's all these different ways of exposure. Does that sort of answer it? Okay. In a way longer way than you thought. Please. Yeah.
Well, when you cite the statistic about informants, how do you function and maintain trust in a movement when that's their main thing? I mean, you know, the Buffalo community is small, and we probably all know each other, you know, six different ways, and we might find out we're related if we talk to each other long enough.
Right.
But that seems to be the scariest thing that you've said all night.
Mm-hmm. Well, think about this, though, right? The worst things, except for going to prison or being killed, have happened to me. I still trust people. Because that bond that we have of building relationships, if we trust each other, is something they cannot break.
Catch me if
I
fall.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But if somebody breaks that trust, you build a relationship with somebody and you think you've got a relationship and you have a trust.
Are you doing clandestine actions? Then what does it matter?
Well, now you sound like some other people.
No, I'm telling you, if you're not engaged in clandestine action, it does not matter.
Okay.
It doesn't matter. I mean, you're working with Food Not Bombs? Whoa, that's scary. You know, like you're like gonna organize a demonstration? Scary. It's none of that stuff. That's all quid pro quo. That's what we do. They know that. Sleeping Dragons, they know we build all those things. It doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter. That's the thing, is we're always like, well, we have some secret that we don't want them to know. What is it we don't want them to know? There is nothing that we don't want them to know. Because we are real people in the real world, we are sharing our hearts and our love for building this stuff. And we will resist. The fact that I will advocate for property destruction doesn't mean I'm a bad or crazy person. I'll talk about that in public. I'm standing in front of y'all talking about that in public. But if there's an informant amongst us, so what? It's on public record anyway. I've written about it. You know, like, we must be transparent. If you believe in things and you want change to happen, and your analysis is that things must change, you must be transparent about it. Because otherwise, you're only talking to the other four people who are going to do that. We cannot worry about informants. We have way more wing nuts in our movements than we do informants.
That's not very
true
either.
Okay.
I have two things. One is a point to tag on to what Kelly said, and a question to follow up. Dylan?
Yes.
Hi. How you doing? I guess I got to tag on to Kelly because that's the most recent one. Is okay, it's true that we don't have anything to hide because we're not doing clandestine actions, so we don't have anything to hide, so we don't have to worry about that. But at the same time, if there are informants like that that do that shit, what's scary is not that we have something to hide, but what the results of that are. And that's, you know, surveillance and harassment by the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's, you know, that is a problem that there is, you know, I'm not saying it's not a problem on such a small scale.
But don't confuse things. Informants, we use informants as the catch-all. There's two different categories. There's informants who gather information and provocateurs who provoke you to do something. all the, I used the word informants, I shouldn't have done that because this came from the Mother Jones article, is that those people were provocateurs. They weren't just gathering information, they were provoking people to do things. The NATO 5, the Chicago people, all of these people is all provocateurs are doing that. So how many people in here, be honest, if somebody you barely know comes up to you and says, let's blow something up, are gonna do it? How many people are gonna go, that's a stupid, crazy idea. Raise your hand.
I've got a bomb in my back pocket.
You know what I'm saying? Like any rational, reasonable person. And if you look at all the cases, who do they go after? Young people who are new to the movement, who have these emergency hearts that want to make change immediately, but haven't been shown and mentored to all the things to ease up on it. A friend of mine used the analogy one time as like a herd of animals, like we're moving like gazelles or something. And those of us who are kind of older now and like at the center of it, we're protected by all this on the outside, and they're going for the young ones on the outside. That's the MO for it. So when people are coming into movements, if we are afraid of everybody who comes into our movements because they're going to be an informant because they're a 20-year-old kid, well, how are we going to talk to them and go like, hey, be careful? But if we talk about this openly and say, if anybody's advocating something that you think is not great, don't work with them and tell other people about it or take them aside. Because I do have people, I've had lots of people, including Brandon Darby, who came to me and said they wanted to do things like arson or in Brandon's case, he actually wanted to shoot people at Walmart. And I didn't turn them in. The same with Brad and David. They came and confided into Brandon Darby, and he should have done the same thing. I talked Brandon Darby out of it. And then Brandon Darby should have done the same thing to Brad and David. He did. He encouraged them because he was working for the FBI. He was a provocateur. He was encouraging them to do it. He didn't make them do it. He didn't lead them to the... He just ideologically led them to it. So we need to protect the young people who come into our movements, not just by age, people who are new to movements. We need to protect them and make sure that we have... And transparency is the only way to do it. And then people worry about this giant police state. Well, you know what? Let's worry about the giant real police state like they had in Nicaragua or in Colombia and places like that. Let's worry about that when it's here or in Argentina where they're disappearing people. When people start being disappeared, then we will worry about it. But right now, let's don't pretend like we're revolutionaries. Let's don't pretend that we're under siege. We're under siege to a degree, but in a privileged way. And I think it's really important. And I'm sorry, I'm not minimizing y'all's case or anything like that.
Thought.
Yeah, so...
The dude, you had me hanging on the edge of my seat for
the second...
And I got you next. And I got you third.
The second piece of what I wanted to say is, earlier you said, and it's related to what Dylan said, but earlier you said that, right in the beginning, you said, do you think that we're all born knowing that there's something wrong with mm-hmm. this society? Mm-hmm. And I agree with that, and I'm trying to figure out, that's one of my concerns as a media activist and someone who's contributing work to change the cultural narrative, right? How is it that you think that, first of all, how did you know something was wrong? It's a question I wish I would have asked you in the interview. But how is it that you think that people know? And I think it's partly related to, you know, that the change of, you know, throwing our own propaganda.
Because the reason that we know things are wrong is because we're perceptive animals. And that we look around and like, we're like, why do some people live like they live? This is usually with people who are not in privilege. In privilege, it was like, oh yeah, everybody has a pool, you know, the giant pool and butlers and things like that. But if you don't have that, you start to go like, why is my family like this? Why did my family go to prison? I mean, I started to ask these questions at a young age, which I didn't even have the answers to. Because I didn't have any understanding about economics and politics at those times, but I knew innately it was wrong. My visceral reaction when people wanted to smash frogs with their feet or a baseball bat was to stop them from doing that. I knew it was wrong. It hurt my feelings. Like, I didn't, nobody had to tell me that. That's how we know. And we have to listen to our compasses inside, our ethics, and build our own. And don't listen to morality of the could, woulda, shoulda, but the ethics that we build ourselves. But what happened for me was that I had this rebellion against things, and I was wanting to create other things, but I didn't have a language for it. And anarchism just became a political reference for those ideas. And whether people, you know, other people have found it in other ways. And those are all valid ways. So.
Yes. I'll just tag on. Just ask a question. Is anyone here a federal agent?
Yeah, they're gonna raise their hand.
I think they are.
Pan the camera around.
You want
$30,000 to buy
windows. Well, has anyone received compensation to do that later? Because they're required. They're required to.
They're not going to have those. I've seen that so many times. And
my
idea inspired. Later on,
yeah.
I was like, oh, that person was an informant. And you know, like, I've had so many informants. Like, I'll give you one little story, too. In 2000, the Republican National Convention, we had these three union guys who were helping us build the puppets for before the Republican National Convention and stuff. These big burly guys. We let them drink beer, cuss, and eat meat in this vegan warehouse that we were all at. We were like little skinny kids and stuff. And so when we came down to do a lockdown, one of the informants, when we asked that question, is like, anybody here in law enforcement? Of course they didn't raise their damn hands. And I handed my keys to the guy, and he drove us into a trap because he was a state trooper working for the FBI. Then I was interrogated by the FBI in prison. That's a whole different story, though. Nate.
I have a statement and a question. The first thing, I think a couple of questions, and this is what I gather from.
Oh man, are we going to go at it for about 5 hours?
No. No, a couple of questions. Like, I think you addressed it earlier in the presentation.
Oh, and I forgot. There was a lot of stuff in here.
No, but when people said, you know, like, what about an FBI agent or an infiltrator, and they're not, you know, but we're not doing clandestine actions. You know, but you said, like, if there's people in an organization who are doing unethical behavior on a consistent basis, kick them out.
Yep.
Or don't want them to be there. And so I think, and I agree, like, even though I'm not going to do a clandestine action, I don't want to be around some people, whether it's, like you said, like, whether they're doing really negative, like, harassment behavior to, like,
or sexist behavior,
level,
or what, you know,
or anything. Like, I think it's okay.
Transphobic.
We have to, like, be able to do that, and I think that's a way to deal with those things.
No, totally.
You're not doing, like, wild stuff. And the second question is, you talked about misogyny and...
Is that a question? That was a statement.
No, that was a statement. That was a statement. Okay. This is the question.
I was looking for the question. I was like, oh.
All right. That was an
extension. Grew a beard during that question. Okay, go.
You talked about misogyny in the movement and sexism. Mm-hmm. And I just want to know what the lessons you learned and how you organize now differently and what how does that come out? And like, yeah, how do we combat that?
Oh my gosh, really? I don't say it because I want to be dismissive of it. It's a really complicated, those are complicated answers. And I don't have all the answers to it. I think that we're always struggling along with it. I think first talking about it and recognizing it is the first step in that. And then communities addressing it in the way that they think is important, like through accountability processes, setting guidelines, and having having principles that they organize around in spaces, creating safe spaces. I think these are some of the ways that we deal with it. I think creating spaces where people can grieve about rape and sexual assault that's happened to them in the past, or the treatment that marginalized people have gotten in their lives, creating safe spaces for them, and then also creating spaces where they can vent those things, I think are ways to do it. Support groups. Those would be like support groups, like we were talking about RC last night. I think that and you understand that I'm just telling you a few pieces. Y'all probably have much better tools than dealing with this. But with sexist behavior from a male-identified person and continually, that we must confront that. Not in a moralistic way, woulda, coulda, shoulda, like pointing fingers, but like in a caring way. And if they don't go with it that way, then you start to move to this thing where, like, if you refuse to be accountable, then your interests are not the same as ours, and we need you to leave. And if they don't do that, then you remove them. It's done. And I don't mean all in one meeting this is happening, right? But I would propose that we also build a movement or a series of movements built on ethics and not morality. Morality has been imposed on us from churches and economic systems and things that we didn't have anything to do with. And ethics comes from within, where we decide what's right for our communities and what's right for ourselves. And each community may have similar ideas, similar principles, but they might be different because you have different needs and different cultures that you're dealing with in your community. And these are some of the ways I would consider to address it.
They call it survival of the fittest.
No, I wouldn't say that. I would say survival of all of us, really. And I think the other piece of that is that we need to be careful about being reactionary, again, by carrying moralism to it, that assuming that everybody in this room is coming from the same place. All of our histories brought us to this point, and we all, at this moment that we are here, and we all have complicated histories that are all part of it. And politics does not explain it all. You can't explain everything away with sexism or patriarchy or capitalism. We are also, you know, alcoholism and dysfunctional families and all these things. And sure, they overarching may be these systems that have created these things, but these are things that all affect us and create us as complex social beings. And I think it's important to look at it like that. Yes, sir.
I have two questions.
Great.
One, brilliant.
No.
One.
This is engaging. I like it.
One, you were talking about earlier with the Common Ground Collective when it was more of an autonomous group before you became a non-for-profit, and you said you tried to organize on various levels of oppressions and then kind of defaulted to focusing mainly on
race.
Racial hierarchies. Yeah. If you could tell a story of that, I think it might actually complement Nate's question about combating sexism in movements.
Okay.
And the second question, I'll just give you straight
did
up.
Did I forget one of the two?
Oh, second.
Okay, no, but go with this one.
It's a succinct statement, but feel free to go on off about it. So you're talking about ethics. That's something I've actually looked into in the last couple of years, particularly from...
I'm exploring it also.
So
I'm exploring it also.
Yeah. So I'm curious about your thoughts of why Gather would be a critical anti-capitalist ethics, right? Because one in which, you know, it incorporates everything you said, but coming from anarchist traditions, the socialist traditions, as well as, you know, looking at new, like, post-structural stuff, like focusing on, like, you know, focusing on feminism, like, all this stuff, what do you, in your opinion, see as possibly, like, I guess you can say path, or what would be your postulation at the moment? So,
So when I go to the first one,
dude, did you just say that?
I get the transcript. Right?
That's one of the things that happened was it was a mixed bag. So like, in doing things like in creating the hierarchy of oppression, one of the things that happened was the institutional way that the left looks at identity politics, which had nothing to do with Common Ground, but we come into the structure, right? And so the Institute for People's Survival, which started anti-racist training, their training is not an anti-oppression training. Their training is an anti-racist training. They actually say that. They're like, we don't care about the other forms of oppression. This is the only one that we'll address because we believe this is the overarching thing. So being white, mostly middle-class people who are coming to this, we have to follow their lead because it's their communities that we're in. So in that, we put thousands of people through these trainings, right? The other thing that we try to do is set up a culture, an anti-oppressing, I'm tired of being against things that I mentioned that earlier. So what we are for is collective liberation, the liberation of all of us in different forms, right? So what we try to do is set up a culture of collective liberation. And the way we did that was like through the orientation you came through. We talked about the history of New Orleans. We talked about these things. And we would go to the anti-racist trainings. It's in all of our literature and our manuals. It was posted on walls and stuff. But because we were following the lead of the People's Institute, we focused on race more than anything. And so what happened was that even though we had women who were very powerful in the organization, and this is a heartbreaking thing that happened, at one point, Brandon Darby was forced away in 2006. But because of post-traumatic stress and a series of events, he politicked his way back in to become the key coordinator in early 2007. Now, I'm not going to put it all on Brandon. This is just a clear example. And there was about 40 queer women who had been organizing and were some of the main coordinators that we had. And what he did was he got a security force and rounded up and fired all of them. Nobody was getting paid. And he rounded up and took them all out.
What?
And nobody spoke up. Hardly at all.
So, get what you're saying, security force.
Yeah, they basically said, they walked with him and said, they didn't beat him up or anything. It was like, you got to take your shit and leave. And they got rid of all of them.
Take your ideas with you.
It shouldn't have happened. One, because Brandon should never come back. But I'm not putting it all on him. I have to own these things, right? But that was a very clear example of it. The other example I would give is that even though we tried to power share, there were some people who had more power in the organization. And guess who that was? not Sharon Johnson, myself, and Malik, but Brandon Darby, myself, and Malik. And when I say more power, I still couldn't get anything done. It was like you have to understand, it was a train that was careening down the path at 150 miles an hour, almost going off the tracks over and over again, and sometimes it would just fall off the edge, right? So nobody, and there was nobody driving it. So, so like if a woman like Lisa Fithian, who was a powerful woman in the organization, made a decision and Brandon didn't like it or Malik didn't like it, they could veto her decision, even though it was a collective of 10 or 12 people making that decision. That's the way it worked out. And the fact that we didn't consciously say that we want a collective liberation analysis and force the People's Institute either to just do anti-racist trainings and then get other anti-oppression trainings, and then the work groups that we formed were also anti-racist work groups. Those were mistakes that we made that I wish we hadn't made in creating that culture. And I have lots of regrets, but I have, you know, like I recognize also, like, had we built this organization before we got into a disaster, it would have looked a whole different way. And so that's what we should organize for now, is these things and build food security and all these, start creating organizations, not built around apocalypse and disaster, but that are ready to move in these ways, that are liberatory. Yeah. And that's what, one of the things I would hope that we would do and continue to do that. And I think that we should, in not being against stuff and not being, we need to stop being anti-racist, anti-sexist. I think we need to recognize those things, but recognize that we're for collective liberation of all people who have been historically marginalized or neglected in our communities, and help support those communities to build their power, or those individuals to build their own power, so we can do it all together. Mm. And I think that's the other thing. As far as ethics, that is way more tricky. I'm writing about it in my next book, because I want us to start to create a body politic based on ethics. And I'm not the only one. There's an anarchist renaissance right now that's going on. A lot of anarchist writers are talking about things, and there's a whole flourishing of books that are coming out now. And one of the movements in the insurrectionary tendency, which is just one tendency of it, is the idea of basing politics on ethics and not on morality. And how we would build that, and how we start to create that, is first by having the conversation, by asking the question, do we want to have a politics of morality or politics of ethics? Yeah. And then start to explore that, not in an abstract way, but in a concrete way. And then I think the community is going to have to build it. And I don't have the answer to that. And I wish I could. I have some ideas about it, but I'm just exploring it.
It's ethics. No one really has.
No, exactly. But the thing is, if we know that things are innately wrong, and we know that some things are right, you know it. You know it. Like, there's times when you have that gut reaction, you're like, I know that's wrong.
What is the good? What is the
right? And so where do we find that we cross over in that? Yeah. And then we start to build this organization together. The relationships, right? And I think it'll look different in different communities. But I think that I would even argue, maybe that some of the framework of anarchy is that, like, voluntary association, solidarity, mutual aid. Those are based on ethics because they're really abstract ideas, right? But you can put ethic values in them that is like that doesn't say that it always has to be this way, and that, you know, God said it's going to be this way and the state said it's going to be, but that we say it makes sense to us. And to me, that's a beginning step, a baby step. And ask me again when I come back through, because then we'll have it developed.
Oh, definitely.
I'll have some idea, and you don't have to agree with it, but there'll be something in there.
That's a long conversation.
Right. And you know what? Because we talk about a lot about state repression, I want y'all to do something for me, because we have good people in your community who need support right now, who are facing a lot of repression. And I want you to dig deep, and we're going to pass the hat one more time for Teresa and for Leslie. Would you mind doing that for me, Nate? And if you gave money, give some more money, because this is a valuable space, and these are valuable people in your community. I know you value these people, and it takes all of us to do this, and that we must show solidarity and give mutual aid to each other, because we're all in this together. And I want to ask you this last question. So now, we've had all these conversations, and it's like candy. We're all high, and we're thinking about it. I'm high, I don't know, maybe you are not. So we're standing on the edge of potential. So how's it gonna look, everybody? Thank you so much for coming out.
Thank you.
You can find me on Facecrack and Twitter if you want to. It would be just between you, me, corporations, the government agencies. I have books for sale for $15 to $20 if anybody wants any. Also.